Hey, what's going on, guys? It's Nando. Thanks for stopping by. Welcome back to another video. And on today's video, we're going to be talking about the return of the ecosystem. The ecosystem fights back. Everything that we know about that Apple ecosystem has just taken it to another level. Now, there's tons of videos out there talking about iOS 14, iPadOS, WatchOS, tvOS. I want this video to focus on primarily the ecosystem. The message I'm trying to convey is that the ecosystem, the walled garden that Apple prides itself in, that everybody discusses, loves or hates, is back, and it's back with a vengeance. Primarily, the merger of macOS and iOS and iPadOS. We'll talk about that here in a second. So let's kind of go here and let's go around a little bit on Apple's website, just so we have an idea of what we're talking about. So macOS, Big Sur is what they're calling it. I don't know anything about that. Whatever. Let me know in the comment section below how you feel regarding that. Okay. So here we have macOS. But the one thing, the number one thing that I want to focus on in this video, again, about that ecosystem, is the fact that Apple, now coming out with their custom Apple processors, is going to allow people to run iPhone and iPad apps natively on future Macs with those new Apple processors. Why is that important? Think about it. Apps that you have on your iPhone, apps that you have on your iPad, being able to take those apps, that experience, and use it on your laptop, your desktop, being able to seamlessly switch between one to the other through and through. Eventually, one could even argue that macOS or some form of macOS might find its way onto iPadOS, which a lot of people have asked for. Some people have been against it. I'm a favor for bringing me Final Cut Pro into the iPad ecosystem, those kinds of things. I don't really care if macOS makes its way to iPad, but if I can have Final Cut Pro, if I can have those kinds of first-party apps that Apple develops on my iPad, I'm all for it. Let me know in the comment section below what you guys think regarding that. So now that we know we're going to be able to do iPhone apps, iPad apps on the Mac, why and who cares about that? Well, think about it. If you already are someone who's seriously invested in the Apple ecosystem, iPhones, iPads, Apple Watches, AirPods, heck, even AirPods are going to be able to seamlessly detect if you are putting your iPhone down, if you are picking your iPad up, and being able to seamlessly switch between the two. Your Apple Watch is going to be able to carry your conversations like they've done before, even more so between those apps. Being able to just go from one thing to another, back and forth, back and forth. There is no other experience out there like that. And it's making me want to give up my, what am I using right now? The Samsung S20 Ultra. I use an iPad and I use a MacBook Pro. I have AirPods and I believe that's it right now for me in the Apple ecosystem. I've been all in. I've used iPhones. You guys have seen me review it on this channel. I've used Mac Minis. I've used iMacs. I've used Apple Watches. I've used every form of AirPods. But right now, just iPad and MacBook Pro. But I'm so excited about the ability. Not that to me that there are apps that I miss when I'm using my MacBook Pro, but being able to use those things and just have it as an option is crucial. Look at what Windows has been trying to do for a very long time. Windows phones failed because Windows phones had no apps. Windows computers, Surface Pros, anything like that, or other manufacturers, when you're using their convertible style, when you're switching, for example, the Surface Pro, and you take it off of the detachable keyboard and it goes into tablet mode, it has an absolutely horrendous experience in tablet mode. The apps aren't there. The app experience isn't there. The apps that are there are very lackluster. Apple has been killing the app game, period. Everybody knows that. Sure, Google has tons of apps, but you can't compete with Apple and their app store. When I'm using my iPad, which is obviously all app-based, apps for everything. When you're on a computer, when you're on your MacBook, sometimes apps make sense. Sometimes apps are what you need in order to have that experience be better. Now, All newly created and existing compatible iPhone and iPad apps will be made available on Mac. So your compatible apps will be published on the Mac App Store on Apple Silicon Maps, or Macs, I'm sorry, unless you end their availability. So right off the bat, boom, iOS app on Mac, Box and App Store Connect. So this is after years of Apple rumoring to switch to custom processors. Apple already makes their processors for iOS and iPads. So this makes sense. This makes a lot of sense. It's going to take a while. It's going to be a couple years. What Apple is doing is making sure that if you are in the ecosystem, you have no reason to ever leave that ecosystem. One could also argue that Apple, even with their credit card, if you are in the ecosystem, you don't want to leave the ecosystem because it's so hard to leave it. iMessages, iPads, iPhones, Macs, MacBook Pros, Apple Watches, AirPods. I mean, if you really truly want to invest in the ecosystem, when you invest in Apple, you're investing in that ecosystem, that walled garden. Bringing apps to your Macs and iMacs and MacBook Pros and MacBook Airs just seems like the next logical step to me. Eventually, I think that bringing those hardcore first-party apps, Final Cut Pro and such, to iPadOS would be the next logical step. That's my take. That's what I'm hoping for. Let me know in the comment section below what you guys think of Apple bringing apps from iPad, from iPhone, to the Mac. Do you like it? Do you hate it? And why? Again, if you like these kind of videos, guys, give me a thumbs up and subscribe, please. That helps me out a lot. And I'll catch you guys in the next video. I've got some reviews coming up as well. Adios, peace, salute, and don't forget to stay geeky.